It is good to be here. Had a wonderful time with everyone at the ordination service, and I gave a little bit of a talk of what the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Canada does, and greetings from our whole team at the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Canada. You saw Evaldo up here the last few days. He's our communications director. Now you're seeing Daniel Saw, who is our health director for the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Canada. He works for ADRA, though. He does his work as a volunteer for the Seventh-day Adventist Church. He is paid a little bit from the Seventh-day Adventist Church for monitoring with ADRA ministries of compassion, and does a great work in the what ADRA is doing here with the national program. So if you have any questions about the national program of ADRA, Daniel is the one to go to. We're doing a wonderful work with ADRA, especially with our community gardens, trying to get our churches active with our communities. So it is great to do that. And at the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Canada, my work here is to support our conferences across Canada and our one mission. When Jesus came to this earth, one of the most outstanding works that he did was on the Last Supper, where he took off his robe and he washed his disciples' feet. The work of the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Canada, people, is to serve our conferences. The work that goes on at the local church and the local school is the most important work that goes on around the world for our church. And so all systems, the General Conference, the North American Division, the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Canada, does everything to support our conferences, which makes sure we have strong churches and strong schools. So anyways, greetings from the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Canada. It is good to be here. I haven't spoken for a camp meeting for a long time. In fact, the last time I was here in Mansask was 2011, a long time ago. And it's great to be back. I love to tell stories. And the reason I love to tell stories is I have spent most of my ministry in youth ministries, either teaching or either as youth director or camp director or even education superintendent. And so I love to tell stories because young people remember stories. In fact, most people do. If you look at the Bible, Jesus told what? Stories. People remember stories. They have a huge impact on us. They move us. When Jesus would use an object lesson, people would remember it. He didn't use theological discussions. He used stories to help people understand the kingdom of God. And so I love stories. A few of you here might have heard me tell a few of my stories, but it doesn't matter. I'm going to tell one of them again. It's an important story for my life, because it made a huge impact in me, in my prayer life, when I heard this story. So I want to tell you a story about a lady named Helmi. Helmi lived in the country of Estonia. She was born in the city of Tallinn. Her husband's name was Robert. Robert was a merchant marine. He spoke 7 different languages, and he traveled around the world on ships, delivering things and picking up things and bringing it back to Estonia. During their course of life, Helmi gave birth to 3 kids. When this story takes place, she has a son named Joel, who is 14. She has a daughter named Esther, who is 9, the higher end of 9. And she has a daughter named Aleka, the lower end of 8. They wanted to get the diapers out of the way. And so they were raising their kids. At this time, the Second World War broke out, and the country of Estonia was a city, Tallinn was a city that was a port that was opening up to the Baltic Sea, and the communist government wanted that, and Germany wanted that, and so they started fighting over it. The Russians, the communist Russian government sent their soldiers in, and they took over it, and it was not a good thing for people there in the country of Estonia, because Russia at that time had gone through a lot of communist ideology and indoctrinating for many years. And so when the soldiers came into Estonia, they were not too kind. If you were a young lady, it didn't fare well for you, and they tried to hide their daughters. If you were older and there was not enough food to go around, the soldiers would shoot you. Helmi's parents were killed. Robert's parents were killed because mere reason of not having enough food. So war was difficult. Soon after the communist government had come and taken over, the Russian army had come and taken over Estonia, the Germans came along and pushed them out during the time that they had some strength at that time. And they came in and they moved them out. The Estonian people actually liked the German army that came in. You know, we read stories about them not being nice and all that stuff, but in Estonia, the story was different. Helmi said that, yes, certain people went missing, but you didn't hear about it, you didn't know about it, they just disappeared. But for the most part, the soldiers were very kind and courteous to the Estonian people. Well, as the war lingered on, Helmi's husband worked for the Estonian secret police. Part of his job was intercepting German and Russian interceptions on the airwaves. They would decipher it so they knew what would be happening to their country. They didn't want Russia there and they didn't want Germany there. They wanted to have autonomy over their own country. But the German army found out that the ship that Robert was on at that time was intercepting these messages, and one of the U-boats sent a torpedo out and demolished that boat. Blew it up, no survivors. That night that it blew up, Helmi woke up at home, and she had a very bad feeling that her husband was no longer alive. 2 weeks later, she got confirmation that on the same night that she woke up, that her husband had passed away at the torpedo's explosion that hit the ship. Now she was here, a widow, raising three kids in the middle of a war. The German army came to her and said, Helmi, you have an apartment that has three bedrooms. Since the bombings, the Russians are bombing us, We're losing houses upon houses and apartment upon apartment. We have to move people together. So you and your three kids can have one bedroom and you will rent out the other two to people that work in our office. So Helmi started renting out her apartment to two ladies that worked for the German High Command. These two ladies were also dating officers in the German High Command, which was a good thing for Helmi because during the war, food was not very plentiful. She had rations, but every time the officers came over as they were courting these girls, Helmi would find a pound of flour on her kitchen table. Sometimes it was butter, sometimes it was eggs, sometimes it was even sugar. So Helmi didn't complain renting out her room because it meant that her and her family had enough food to live on. As the war raged on, the German officers sat Helmi down. They said, Helmi, is there a way for you to get out of the country? We're not going to be able to hold on to Estonia much longer. We're losing the war on all fronts. We just can't do it anymore. And when we leave, the communist soldiers will come in and it will be very difficult for you. Helmi knew what they were saying to her. She did not want to raise her three kids in a communist country where God was not thought of, where atheism was pushed in people's minds. She could not raise her kids as Seventh-day Adventists in the country if communism took over. So Helmi did what she knew to do, which was pray. The soldiers warned her as the Russian army came closer and closer to the city of Tallinn. So one Sabbath, she went to church and she had been praying for a way out, and they were discussing it at church that Sabbath and at the Seventh-day Adventist church in Tallinn, saying, how can we get out of Tallinn to Sweden, to freedom? For Sweden had opened up their doors to the Estonian people that were escaping there, and they were looking for a way out. And the pastor said, there is a train leaving next week. If we get on that train, it will take us to Germany, to the port city of in Germany, and that boat, we can get on a boat that will take us to Sweden. And so they all made plans. So Helmi said to them, when does this train leave? The pastor looked at her and said, Helmi, it leaves next Sabbath. Helmi left church that day just bothered. Because she knew in the Bible it says, pray that your flight is neither in winter nor on the Sabbath. And Helmi did not want to travel on the Sabbath. Or in winter, which it wasn't. So next Sabbath, when she showed up at church, she showed up to a nearly empty church. Most of the people were on that train going to the port city in Germany to take the boat over to Sweden. Helmi looked around and was very sad because she wanted to get out. You could hear every day and every night the bombing getting closer and closer to the city, knowing that the Russian-German front was edging closer to Tallinn. Once it hit Tallinn, Tallinn would fall. So that week, when Helmi woke up Sunday morning, she was praying. When she woke up Monday morning, she was praying. When she woke up Tuesday morning and Wednesday morning, she was praying. By Wednesday night, she had exhausted herself, but she stayed up all night praying. So early Thursday morning, she had no idea what to do. She said, I'm going to go out and walk the streets and pray. So around 3:30 in the morning, she heads out on those cobblestone streets in Tallinn, and she starts walking the street back and forth going, Lord, how am I going to get out? Where am I going to get out? How can I raise my kids in a communist country? I can't. Could you please provide a way out? As she's listening to the war go on in the next precinct that she lived next to, the bombing was coming close. And as she was praying away, she's walking down the street, she sees a lady dressed in gray on the other side of the street coming towards her. The lady crosses the road, walks right up to Helmi and says, Helmi, she knew her name. You and your three kids are looking to get out of the country, are you not? Helmi nodded and said, yes, still bewildered. How does this lady know me? How does she know I have three kids? And who is she? The lady said, listen, if you go down to the port down in Tallinn and dock number B, if you go down to dock number B, there's going to be a boat there, and you and your kids will get on that boat. Helmi just shook her head, yes, okay. So Helmi was so excited, she turned around and she took a few steps and said, wait, I didn't say thank you. And she turned around again to look. The lady was gone. She didn't have time to think about it. She ran home, woke up the kids, and said, listen, pack what we have. And so they packed a few days of clothing, and they packed their Bibles. They packed a few of the Spirit of Prophecy books. They packed their photos in little tiny suitcases, not big, little tiny ones, and they left. They ran down to where that boat would be. And as they were running down there, they could see the boat at the end of the dock. And Helmi goes, I know that boat. I know the captain and I know the captain's wife. She knew the boat would hold comfortably 500 people. And as they got closer and they neared dock B, they saw 5,000 people waiting to get on this boat. Helmi's heart sank. She said, Lord, you sent me somebody to tell me that I was going to be on the boat. There's 5,000 people waiting to get on a boat that holds 500 people. So as they got closer to the crowds, little Esther said, Mom, there's a building over there. Let's go around that building and it will get us in front of half of the people. Helmi looks down at Esther, good thinking, and they start tearing around this building. And as they round the building, and they're coming there, they said, yes, we can see, we can get in front of the people here. And as they come, all of a sudden, they stopped. Because there was a span of about 8 feet of water between this dock and that dock. And Helmi said, Lord, why have you brought us this far for this water to be here? And as she's thinking of that in her mind and praying that to the Lord, there's a hand that touches her on the shoulder, and she looks up at this huge German soldier. And he looks down at her and says, ma'am, can I help you with anything? She goes, yes, we need to get on that side from here. What can you do? Can you take us around? He says, no, no problem. I'm going to throw you guys across. I'm a strong soldier. So he picked up Elika, and it was no problem to toss an 8-year-old across that. Toss that 8-year-old right across that span of water. He picked up Esther and tossed her across. He picked up Joel, a 14-year-old boy that was starting to get some meat on him, and he tossed him across that water. Helmi stood there and said, oh no, I'm a lady with strong bones. She said, how is he going to throw me across? She closed her eyes and waited for him to pick her up and didn't feel him picking her up. She opened her eyes and she was on the other side of the dock. She looked back to look for the German soldier and he was gone. So now they had 2,500 behind, 2,500 in front. Helmi prayed again. She said, Lord, in the word of God, it says that you parted the Red Sea for the children of Israel to go to freedom. Could you please part these people like you did back then? She told the kids to start walking. As they were walking, remember, this is a boat leaving, possibly the last boat leaving, before the Russians came and took over the port city of Tallinn. And she said, walk. And as they were walking, the people moved out of the way. They walked right up to the boat where they had ropes partitioning the people from the dock and from the boat, getting in between the boat or getting on the boat. There were German soldiers standing there and they had guard dogs with them. So Helmi went up over here and she tried putting her head underneath the rope and the soldiers pushed her back as the dogs barked. She went over here and she tried pushing her head over and the same thing. She was pushed back and the dogs were vicious. Helmi did the only thing that she knew how to do because she had no equipment. She had nothing at her disposal. She prayed. And she said, Lord, in the word you had blinded soldiers before, can you blind these soldiers and the dogs so that we can get on this boat to safety? She said to Elika, Elika, get on. Don't answer any questions. Just get on the boat. Elika went right underneath the rope, past the German soldiers and past the guard dogs who didn't even see her, and walked on the gangplank and got on the boat. Esther followed by the same thing. Joel followed. Helmi, being the big person that she was, she ducked underneath the rope. Not a dog barked, not a soldier's hand upon her head pushing her back, and she walked up the gangplank onto the boat. She got together with her kids away from the gangplank, and they hugged each other and said, we're on the boat. As she hears her name being called down the side of the boat, she turns around and looks. It is the captain's wife running towards her, said, Helmi, Helmi, there's no room on the boat. Go down to the bottom of the boat. When room opens up on one of the berths, you get on there and don't get off till we are out at sea. Said, whatever you hear on the announcement, stay on the boat. So Helmi goes down with her kids, and as they go down there, there is no room for anyone. People that had gotten there early had their trunks full of their worldly possessions as they were getting this boat out of Estonia to Sweden. And then all of a sudden they heard on the PA system the captain's voice, and the captain said, this boat is no longer going to Sweden. It is going to a port city in Germany. People looked at each other, they shook heads, and all of a sudden people started to leave the boat. They were taking their huge trunks off the boat. When a berth got open up, she told her kids to get in there, and they laid down on the area where they could sleep at night. They locked their things away in little tiny compartments that they had, and they waited. And they waited. And as people left the boat, people came on that had hardly anything with them. The captain wanted to make sure that boat was full of people and not products. A few minutes go by, an hour goes by, and Helmi hears the engines come to life on the boat. And as they go out to sea, she's gauging it how far they are from the shore by how the boat is rocking. And she said, okay, we can go up now. And so the kids and her run up to the top deck there. And they meet the captain's wife. And the captain's wife says, Helmi, this boat is going to Sweden. We needed to lighten the boat from all the possessions that people had gone in so that we could rescue more people. That boat, that day, was the final boat to leave the country of Estonia under German rule. The next 40-some-odd years, the communist government ruled over that city in Tallinn. And that story is important to me because Helmi's my grandmother. The little girl Esther, that's my mom. I grew up hearing that story from my grandmother and also from my mom. Just, it was a Sabbath story that my mom would love to tell growing up. That had a big impact on my life, knowing that we have a God that loves us, knowing that we have a God that is willing to empty heaven for you and I, if we learn to trust. You see, people, not too many of us are good at trusting God. We do a lot of worrying. We do a lot of doubting. We do a lot of things that put a span of doubt between us and the Lord when the Lord says, trust me. You see, there's three guys in the book of Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that decided to trust God instead of trusting the king, no matter what the threats are. And they walked into a fiery furnace, and the Lord Jesus shows up. One like the Son of Man shows up. That was the king talking. That was Jesus that showed up. They came walking out of there. The amazing thing is that these three people did very little protesting. They didn't get their friends together to riot that day. They were faithful even unto death. You see, their good friend Daniel had his experience. And you know that story, and some of you have heard me talk about that story. Daniel is there, and he has been picked by the new king to be one of the 120 governors. But out of them, three of them were probably going to be chosen to be the head honchos. And out of those three, one of them was going to be the one to report to the king. Everybody knew it was Daniel, and Daniel was not a favored person by some of the other groups that were there. They didn't like Daniel because they knew he was a good guy, and they knew the king would probably pick Daniel, and they didn't want Daniel picked, so they started to do their political aspirations of controlling the situation. And they looked to see if they could find anything wrong with Daniel. They couldn't. They get the king and they pull the wool over his eyes and said, King, nobody can pray to anybody but you for the next 30 days. And put that into law. And that anybody that doesn't do that, lion's den. And the king, you know, listening to them and them buttering him up and them saying great things about the king, said, okay, I'll do it. And he puts it into law. And the next day, we know the story. Daniel's at his window praying, facing to where Jerusalem was, and praying. They got out their cell phones, and they started to take pictures, and they started posting them to Instagram and Facebook. No, they didn't do that back then, did they? But they went running to the king. And they went running to the king, and you could just picture it as they go running to the king, and they said, King, did we not just make a law that nobody could pray to anybody but you for 30 days and all that stuff? We found somebody that did. And the king was like, oh, yeah, somebody did that? Who? Daniel. Have you ever had any of those times where the blood leaves your head? Where you know you have messed up royally? My wife's not here today because we're traveling tomorrow. She's doing laundry, so I can tell this story. I did that once to my wife. We were living in a city in the United States. I was principal of a school that was very difficult. And I remember the day, it was May 20th, where I came home from work exhausted. My wife said, let's go for a walk. So after dinner, we went for a walk. And we're walking down to the park. And Sonia goes, Paul, how was your day? And I was just like, oh, it was awful. The kids were terrible. Oh, I have so much paperwork. I have so much grading to do. The government want these more. It was terrible. Oh, boy. And I go, Sonia, how was your day? She goes, oh, it was pretty good, even though it was my birthday. I felt the blood leave my head. But when it did this to the king, it was to a trusted servant of his. When the blood left his head and he started to realize this was Daniel that had been conspired against, and it was a good friend of his, and he trusted him, and he knew that this guy served all the other kings faithfully, he went, oh no. He called up his lawyers and he said, guys, is there a way that we can get Daniel off the hook? And so all day long, they look at the books and they can't. You have put it into law. It cannot be revoked. And if you notice during this story, people, Daniel stays amazingly silent. You see, if it was me, I'd be calling everybody I knew in, you know, rock phones back then, whatever they had. I would be calling everybody and saying, listen, I need you to protest. I need you to get a demonstration going. I need you to do this. I need you to do that. I'd be on Facebook. I'd be getting everybody there. But Daniel didn't. He trusted God. And he stayed silent. You see, people, when we have a God who calls us his children, you and I do not need to worry. Right now, in the most holy place, where Jesus ministers as our high priest, he is not walking back and forth, biting his fingernails, worrying about what goes on here at earth. He knows the end from the beginning. He is about his Father's business. People, if Jesus is not worried at what goes on, and we are fully in his hands, even if death overcomes us on his earth, we're still in his hands. I want you to picture yourself on the earth made new 3 billion years from now. Are you going to be hurt about what went on in this earth? Are you going to be mad if you, my dad told me, he said, I want to live to 86. Well, he didn't. He lived to 84. My dad was mad about that. He can't protest right now. He's in the grave. When we're on the earth made new, sin has been eradicated. We are with our Father. We are with our brother Jesus. We do not have to worry. Focus your eyes on those times, people, because it is at those times where the world that we lived in is so far away, 3 billion years from now. We are going to be living in God's glory. And everything that we went through on this earth is going to be minuscule. So no matter what we go through, always know, people, we are children of God. We are fully in his hands. He has engraved us in the palms of his hands. We are his. Nothing happens to us without him having something to do with it. I'm going to tell you one more story. My brother was an alcoholic for many years. He's no longer alive, died in 2019. I think if you took Everton and myself and put us together, we still would not equal the size of my brother. He was a big guy. I'm the small one of the family. That's hard to believe, and I know that, but I am the small one of my family. My brother was not as tall, but he was a big man. When he passed away, it took 7 men to carry him out to the van. That's how big he was. My brother was a heavy drinker for a good part of his life. My mom and I used to meet once a week to have prayer. I would drive into Toronto from where I was teaching in Oshawa, and I would go there to have prayer with my mom, where we would pray for my brother. I said, Lord, you're going to have to reach my brother. Reach my brother, because I don't want him to die not knowing you. Reach my brother. One day, my mom calls me up and says, Paul, Rob's been in an awful accident. He nearly killed a lady driving drunk. And I just said, Lord, what are you doing here? I asked you to save my brother, not kill him. The Lord was really silent. My brother back then got sentenced to 3 months in jail. Today, if that happened, it would probably be about 10 years in jail. He got sentenced to 3 months. The jail he went to was in Toronto for people that were had small sentences. And my brother was a big guy, and one of the things that happened to him in the jail was he was a big snorer. And when I mean he snored loud, he snored very loud. I remember inviting him while I was working at Camp Frienda up to stay in one of the cabins. I was on the bottom floor. My brother was on the top floor. I slept with a fan on, and I still did not get any sleep that night. He was loud. So my brother, the first night that he's in jail there, he's not in jail cells. They were basically community jails where everybody slept on bunks out in the open there. And he snored all night long. The next morning, there were two Hell's Angels bikers that were in jail for a short term. And they came up to Rob during the day. He said, Rob, is that you snoring that loud? He said, yes. He said, if you snore tonight and keep us awake, we're going to walk over to where you are when the guards aren't around, and we're going to slice your throat. My brother hung around with people like that, and when they threatened that, he knew it was serious. Meanwhile, my mom and I are praying, saying, Lord, what are you doing here? He's in jail. Why are you not reaching? You know he needs help with his alcoholism. You know he needs this. What's happening here? And the Lord just basically whispered back to me and my mom, get out of the way. I'm working here. Trust me. So that night, my brother stayed awake. It was not bad staying awake that night. The next day he would sleep, and he tried sleeping during the day, but the jail was noisy during the day. He had trouble sleeping, and of course they didn't want him snoring during the day because he literally drowned everything out. And so that night he stayed awake, and he was doing everything he could do the second night, staying awake, and he's just laying in bed there, staying awake. He wasn't allowed to walk around, and he said, I gotta stay awake. I don't want my throat slit. He made it through the second night. That day, he was struggling to stay awake. When it came time to nighttime, he said, I can't do that. He slipped out of his bunk onto his knees. My brother had not prayed for years. And he knelt down. He said, Lord, I'm going to die here unless you do something to get me out of here. He managed to stay awake that night. In the morning, when everybody was waking up, word comes down through the guards that my brother is being called to the warden's office. My brother's scared. He walks into the warden's office. The warden says, Rob, you're new here. He goes, yes. You were here because of drunk driving. He goes, yes. He says, are you an alcoholic? Rob goes, yes. He says, sit down. He says, I hear there's a death threat on you by the Hell's Angels. He goes, that's correct, sir. He said, Rob, I have the power to parole you right now. I want to make a deal with you. I know a counselor. If you go to that counselor twice a week for the next 3 months, I will parole you right now. You fail to show up one day, and you'll be back in here for 6 months. My brother walked out of that jail and into a counselor's office that the warden sent him to, who happened to be a Christian. And as she spent time with my brother, she said, Robert, he's named after my grandfather, Robert, there is a higher power, and that higher power is Jesus, and there's nobody that can help you but him. You have to trust him. My brother never went back to jail or in prison, never drank a drop after that. A few months later, he was baptized by Jim Ryan, the dean of men at that time at Kingsway College. Jim struggled because my brother was literally 3 or 4 times the size of Jim Ryan. For those of you know Jim Ryan, Jim's not a big man. Jim and I used to work together in the dorm. Jim's here. Yeah, I'm somewhere else. I'm a lot larger. But I wanted to tell you that story because people, God answers our prayers. We are his children and he loves us dearly. He says, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. He's not going to leave us high and dry. He is going to be by our side all the time. Why do we not trust him? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and Daniel are stories in the prophetic book of Daniel that talk about last days, right? Those stories are not put in there for the fun of it. It's to tell us that we have a God that will walk with us even through the valley of the shadow of death. We do not need to worry what transpires here. And people, even if we might have to lay our heads down in the dust of this earth for a short time, the years the locusts have eaten, God will repay. Everything that sin has done here, God is going to 10 billion times over repay his children and said, listen, I'm giving you eternity, sin-free, with dad, with your brother. Enjoy it. I want to tell you, people, we have a God that takes care of the smallest details of our lives. We just need to recognize, take the blinds of our eyes and say, God, that's you doing that, isn't that? We just need to see in God do that and give him the praise. Can I tell you one more story? Do you mind if I do that? Is there enough time? Okay, I got the okay from Dave. Okay. My wife and I had taken a job. We were leaving the Ontario Conference. I was going out to Nova Scotia to pastor a three-church district. I had a Toyota Camry. My wife had a CRV SUV. And I said to my wife one night, I said, Sonia, our Toyota Camry guzzles more gas than a little Yaris would guzzle, right? And she said, yeah, but we don't have a Yaris, Paul. They said, how about we trade our car in and we buy a Yaris because my district is huge and I want a fuel-efficient car. And Sonia, you know, being the more reasonable one, she said, Paul, we'll drive the Camry into the ground. When that car is totally exhausted, we'll buy a little Yaris. I said, okay, but let's just pray about it. So my wife and I, that night we prayed, they said, Lord, you know the Camry guzzles gas. If you want us to have it and pay more in gas, because if we trade it in right now, we get a Yaris, we're going to be paying more money. And he said, if you want us to have a Yaris, Lord, that's in your hands. And we were talking about a Yaris. We weren't praying about a small car. We were saying a Yaris. That Sabbath came along, and it was alumni weekend at Kingsway College. I had gone there for 1 year, grade 13, when we had it in Ontario. I had also taught at the school. My wife had gone to school at Kingsway College. She had also taught at the school. My sister-in-law teaches there. My mother-in-law is the assistant dean of women there. So we have a connection to Kingsway. So alumni weekend was coming. I came home. I had been preaching in Toronto. And I came home and I said, Sonia, it's alumni weekend. Let's just go to alumni weekend. She said, Paul, I've had the kids all morning. You were gone preaching. You can go and take the kids. I'm going to lay down and have a nap. I said, no problem, Sonia. So I got the kids in there. We lived about 20 minutes north of Oshawa. Got the kids in the car, and of course, they really didn't want to go see my old friends. But anyways, they got in the car, and we went down the road. As we got closer to the campus of Kingsway College, we were on Town Line Road. There was a huge storm coming across the campus of Kingsway College. When I drove on by the elementary school where I used to teach, as I drove on to the property of Kingsway College, it started pouring cats and dogs. Not just, you know, where it's a light rain, where you can have your wipers on high and you can't see anything. It was pouring. In fact, there was probably about that much water on the road. And as I'm going along the road and I'm passing College Park Elementary School, a flash of lightning comes down and hits the hood of my car. The car lights up. All over the place. There was light everywhere. And after it lights up, I looked back at the kids and said, are you guys all right? And they said, yeah, Dad, what happened? I said, lightning just hit our car. The horn was honking and it would not stop. I couldn't stop it from honking. It was just blaring. The engine was just, but it was still running. The lights were on. My dash was on. Everything was on. I couldn't turn anything off and I couldn't even turn the car off. I kept it in drive, and it just puttered down the road. The windshield wipers were not working at that time, but I was managed to curve around into the parking lot of Kingsway College. I called up on the cell phone at that time and said to my father-in-law, Steve, could you get here and bring some tools so I can disconnect? I just got struck by lightning in the car. You know, my wife got on hysterically and all that. We made sure everybody was okay. I went out, opened the trunk in the pouring rain, and just yanked the horn, because it wasn't the small little tiny beep beep. It was a big horn. And I yanked the wires out, got back in the car. My father-in-law came in within about 20 minutes. I took the battery off and the car stopped. I called up the insurance agent and said, hey, listen, my car just got struck by lightning. And she starts laughing. And I said, no, ma'am, I'm not joking. My car just got struck by lightning. She said, oh, you're being serious. I said, yes. And I said, I'm stuck here on the campus of Kingsway College. I can't start the car. I can't do anything. It's just not going to work. I could even see where lightning hit the hood of the car and where it arced out on the water that was touching the rims of my car since the water was so high. They sent us a tow truck. They said, Paul, where should we take it to? I said, take it to the Toyota dealership in Bowmanville, because I live north of Bowmanville. They came and got the car. They took it to the dealership. My father-in-law took us home. Monday morning, they said, Paul, come down to the dealership. The insurance adjuster would be there. So I go down to the dealership. The insurance adjuster's there, said, Paul, your car is totaled. Your car can't, we have to put a special sticker on it that when it goes to the wrecking yard, none of your parts are allowed to be used again, because they're all fused together. The lightning just molded everything together. And they said, you know, you guys were lucky to be alive in that car. And I said, oh, I know that. I said, how much are you going to give for the car? And they said, oh, I'll let you know tomorrow. So he leaves, and the manager of the dealership goes, Paul, come into my office. I want to talk to you. And he goes, comes in. I go in there. And he says, listen, insurance adjusters are not usually fair to people that pay for insurance. Here is the book value of your car. It is worth $9,000. Whatever they do, if they give you anything less than $9,000, you tell them that the blue book value for that car, because the Toyota dealership said so, is $9,000. Tell them it is worth $9,000. So the next day, the insurance adjuster gives me a call. He said, Paul, I noticed that you took good care of that car. You had brand new tires on that car. We are going to give you $11,000 for that car and $600 for your new tires that were destroyed. Would that be okay? Yes. So I went back to the dealership with my wife. We took the check from the insurance company. We said, what can we get for this money? And they said, we have a blue Yaris out there that you could drive it off the lot today. The entire time I was driving in my district, for I think it was about 8 years that I was driving around Nova Scotia, I drove a little tiny Yaris, our lightning miracle car, because God heard our prayers. And people, I'm not saying this because God favors us more or anything like that. We are his children. We are all highly favored by us. If we would just trust in his providence and his care, and even if he doesn't answer how we want the prayer to be answered, he's taking care of it the best way it can possibly ever be taken care of for us. It's just that we need to trust. I know that Daniel was not going, oh, I'm hoping I'm going to go in the lion's den today. He said, no, I'm going to trust my Father in heaven. And he goes into the lion's den, and he comes out of the lion's den alive. And the amazing thing is, the ones that were conspiring for power, for prestige, for Daniel's job, and trying to put the other person down, what happened to them? Yeah, we know they didn't last very long, and their families in the lion's den. All we need to do, people, is trust our God. Whatever we go through, know that he is advocating for us. Know that in the most holy place he is not pacing back and forth, scratching his head, wondering how this is going to end for us. He knows that he is calm. He's ministering calmly before the most holy place, before the mercy seat where our Father sits. If God is for you, who can be against you? So I want to tell you this, people, trust our God. Especially as we inch closer to the second coming, trust God, because no matter what happens to us, he is going to take care of us. And we focus more on the bad times, more on protecting ourselves during those times, than looking up to Jesus and knowing that he is going to be by our side every single step of the way. Like I said, there are four people in the book of Daniel. The end result is that God came through for them when they were faced with death. That is to tell us that we have a God that will take care of us when we go through the same thing before Jesus comes again. People, keep your eyes on Jesus, not on the small things of the terror that we go, oh, we love those things. We love to talk about it. We love to talk about the bad times. But people, we need to talk more about Jesus and the good times of eternity. So I'm going to end now. I'm going to leave you. And what I'm going to ask you to do is pray more. Pray especially for your pastors, your teachers, your principals, your workers in the office. I cannot tell you this, people, but those who are working for the Seventh-day Adventist Church are number one on the devil's hit list. Larry said this yesterday. They are under the greatest attack. I know that personally. And by the way, who will he attack most? Your children. Pray for our leaders. Pray for your pastor. Lift up the families. And when you want to go and maybe say something negative, please be like Daniel and be very silent. Because Daniel had every reason to plead his case to the king. Daniel had every reason to protest. Daniel had every reason to start a demonstration, to start a march down the street to support his freedom, but he stayed silent. People, if we prayed more and talked less, we would see God come through in amazing ways in our lives.